Well, good morning, loungers. Hope everyone is doing well. Thank you, moderators that are here. I see Potato and Angie V right off the bat. Welcome, guys. Hey, Melissa B, you're here for the, and Robin here for this. I know, right? This is crazy. Say hello to Summer Lou is sleeping. And I am getting ready for my trip. So I am packing today, getting things ready to go. And I wanted to let you guys know. What was that noise? Oh, I missed it. Oh, Bronnie Lynn McCann. Followed on Facebook. That's a Facebook alert. Pretty cool. Pretty cool. Check this out. Thank you, Brianni Lynn. And Robin coming in hot with a super chat, $19.99. Thank you. Ridiculousness. Everyone get your tinfoil hats. Okay. And while you're putting those on, I'm going to tell you about the victims. First, we're going to go over the victims in this case. And welcome to chat if you are just joining. Hello, banjo lady. And thank you again,
just
Robin.
Just help a brother out here.
Helping a brother out here. Grady style. Thank you, my fellow Floridian. All right, so let me tell you about the victims. And we're going to go from left to right on the screen. And we're going to start with Riley Allen. Riley Elizabeth Allen was 17 years old. And then we've got Tiffany Guest. Tiffany was 13. And ran cross country in school. She was a seventh grader in choir and had just tried out for cheerleading. That's Tiffany Guess. Then we have Michael Mayo. Michael James Mayo was 15. He played football, ran cross country and track. And his grandfather said he was an all-around fantastic young man who shared a birthday with his grandfather. His grandfather's birthdays will never be the same. And then next we have Ivy. Ivy Webster. She was 14, a friend of Tiffany. She was a great kid who loved animals, according to her mother, Ashley. She loved softball, people, and animals, and she was just a genuine good person. And then lastly, we have Brittany Brewer, who was 16, another one of Tiffany's friends. And according to her father, Nathan Brewer, she aspired to be a teacher or a veterinarian. And he told hundreds of people at a vigil Monday night, it's a parent's worst nightmare and I'm living it. Another little thing about Brittany Brewer, coming up in July, she was selected to be Miss Henryetta. So, heartbreaking. These kids, five kids. And to the left is our perpetrator, who is also deceased, along with his wife, Jesse McFadden. And then he shot his wife and her three teenage children and their two friends. And then allegedly killed himself. But the thing is, do we even know if that's the order that things happened? How do we know? Hey, Brunch. Because they didn't do an investigation. I know it, Robin. It's bad. Okay, so what we're going to do now that we've gone over the victims, we're going to watch the press conference that these guys gave. Now, this is what This is what drew my attention to this case. Was this press conference, and I'm probably going to interrupt it several times because it's absolutely ridiculous. And like I said, this is what made me look at this and go, hold up.
Hold up. Wait a minute. Something ain't right.
There was this text message sent to Ivy's parents Sunday night that was odd, they said. Do we believe that was sent by Jesse?
I'm not sure I know what text message you're talking about, so I...
Let's just start right there. The press knows about a text message sent from, I think he said... I don't know whose phone he said. I didn't understand him. But he's like, what? I don't know what text you're talking about. This guy just got out of prison in 2020. So I don't know if they knew each other before prison. I'm unclear on their relationship. Look at his face. His face says clueless.
I can't comment intelligently.
Were there any signs of a fight?
I didn't observe any, no.
What's your theory of motive?
I don't think I want to speculate. I'm not gonna express a theory because, again, I follow the evidence and I don't have any evidence to indicate what the actual motive was. And I'm going to be honest with you folks.
Hold on. So he admits, I have no evidence. But we find out that he doesn't have any evidence because they didn't take any evidence. There was evidence to be taken, but they didn't take it.
Normal people that understand care, love, compassion wouldn't understand if I could come up with it anyway.
Chief, what kind of impact does this have on law enforcement? I mean, this is now two.
Okay, so I can't even with a straight face with this guy. He says, even if I could come up with the evidence, no normal person would understand it anyway. Okay. So let's possibly let other people that may have been involved in this sickness get away with it and keep hurting more children, you jackass. This guy's a jackass.
Weirdly similar cases that you've had to deal with in just the last 6 months.
Law enforcement is pretty resilient, and we know what we signed up for, and we play the hand that's dealt us. So when we get a...
Okay. So another thing, the scene didn't bother his officers at all. What a supportive chief they have there. He feels like his officers are just resilient. And they can handle anything, even whips and chains and dog leashes and all kinds of nasty shit in a house of horrors. We're resilient. He's out of his damn mind.
Call, we go. And with regard to how anyone is responding to it since the event, I don't have any indication that anybody's having any difficulties. We are conducting the follow-up investigation, which is doing some cleanup interviews and documenting everything that we discovered, just like we do in any other case.
Cleanup interviews, whatever the fuck that means. And documenting whatever they took. And look at his face. AKA, it'll take us 5 minutes because we didn't collect evidence.
Have you heard from other parents, other teenagers? We heard possibly that more teenagers were invited.
I don't have any information along those lines. That's first I've heard of it.
Do we think he planned this?
I don't know.
Do we know if they were doing anything when the killings happened, like an activity of some sort outside?
Wasn't anything obvious.
Do you think he acted alone?
Don't have any evidence to indicate that there was anybody else involved.
But you didn't collect anything. to find out. Lazy. Did they think that that family was just going to come collect shit out of that house and just go on their way? Like, what? These two children that were visitors there? I mean, what?
McFadden's rape conviction and his pending child porn charges, did he have any more recent run-ins with law enforcement that would act as warning signs?
Not that I'm aware of. The absent his prison, his lengthy prison sentence, and his Muskogee County case.
How well did you know this person? I'm assuming he was on the sex offender registry. Is this someone?
Are we talking about Jesse McFadden? I personally did not know him. My understanding is he was a registered sex offender and was up to date on his registration.
So you guys had no prior calls to this house before this incident?
My agency would not have had any. The task force doesn't, as a matter of business, take calls for service. I would defer to the sheriff with that, and I would say that I am unaware of any others.
Chief, you said all...
Wait a minute. This is the task force? Who is this guy? I thought he was the chief of police. Why is he calling it the task force? Is this the Henryetta chief of police or no? You guys let me know.
The victim suffered gunshot wounds to the head. Did they come from the back or the front?
Some were to the side of the head, some were in the back of the head. There were injuries in the front of the head. So I would defer to the medical examiner for a firm answer on that. The short answer is I don't know for sure.
I know you're unsure of what exactly happened. Is there any reason to believe that he did this and then waited a while and then killed himself later on?
Again, I follow the evidence. I don't have any evidence to indicate that. Anything is possible.
Do you have any time? How long do you think they were at that residence when they were gone all weekend? They showed up that Monday. Do you have any idea how long they were at?
My understanding is the girls were friends with Tiffany, who lived at the residence, and were allowed to go and spend the night with her on Saturday and were supposed to come home Sunday, and when they didn't, they were reported missing. Beyond that, I don't have any information.
What were the ages of all the victims?
Bear with me. I knew there was a document I needed to bring with me.
Really? This guy clearly has zero empathy. None. They ask about the victims, and he says, I thought there was a document I also sprang with me. Well, if he's an actress, he's doing a piss-poor job. I think an actress would do better. Actor.
Tiffany was 13.
Ivy was 14.
Michael was 15. Riley was 17. Ivy was 14. Brittany was 16. Holly was 35, and Jesse McFadden was 39.
Just to confirm, the three...
So this dude had to pull it up on his phone, this asshat next to him.
Riley, Tiffany, and Michael were all Holly's kids, not Jesse's.
That is my understanding, yes.
So these were his stepkids?
Yes.
Did he make any recordings on his phone of his deeds or try to post anything to social media that you can determine?
We recovered one phone from the residence that we believe is Holly's. We recovered pieces of a phone from a wooded area quite a ways from the residence. We do not know who it belonged to. If that's not his phone, we haven't located his phone.
Any other significant pieces of evidence other than those phones, the guns, and of course the bodies?
We took some other evidence, but nothing I'm willing to comment on.
Is there any indicator that any of the victims were drugged or anything?
Not that I'm aware of.
With the four family members.
Oh, my God. We took some things, but nothing I'm willing to comment on. Why did they take the drugs?
Being found together, did they appear to be sleeping?
Without going into a lot of detail, that scene appeared to be staged to me. And that is my opinion based on what I observed.
Staged as in the bodies.
I don't want to go into details. I think the bodies had been moved from where they were originally killed.
Were they all found outside?
Yes.
Okay.
But they weren't killed at the same.
So he thinks they were all killed inside and staged outside? was there blood evidence inside? I'm confused.
Time, I mean, some were killed at one occasion, and then just given the distance you're talking about, and traveled somewhere else.
Well, there's no way we can know with certainty, but logic tells me that some were killed in an area 400 to 450 yards away from others. So yeah, there would have been some space of time there. Yes, sir.
Yes. Are you certain about the found sex offender registry status? We intended to look him up and didn't find him there.
I am certain of what I've been told. I have not checked it myself.
What is he talking about? What has he done? What has this dude done? He clearly hasn't talked to the parents of the two deceased girls.
Certain of Brittany Brewer's age. I was told by your father that she was 15.
No, I am not certain. That information was provided to me early on. I made a note of it, and I am not 100% certain of that.
I spoke with a former victim of his who was set to testify against him and the trial he was supposed to be on and on Monday, and he sent her text messages or Facebook messages the night previous. Have you spoken with her? Do you know anything about those messages?
We have. We've received copies of those text messages. He did make contact with her, and I don't think it was a text message. I think it was a Facebook Messenger message. And tried to lay blame for his situation on her.
So do you believe that the killings happened prior or after those messages?
I don't have any way to know that.
I mean, shouldn't that be part of their investigation? I don't have any way to know that. Well, don't you think you should be trying to figure it out? I think the bottom line is they didn't give a rat's ass. Everyone's dead. Nothing to see here. Take this shit, guys, and go. This is too messy. Who knows? One of those 32 phones could belong to a police officer. I think he's trying to go through the motions, and I think that he thinks he's smarter than all of these reporters and that he's going to be able to dupe everybody. I don't think he's an actor. I think he's duping everyone, or thinks he is. By saying, you know, giving the information of where they were shot in the head, but then saying, oh, I think it was staged, but I'm not telling you why.
District Attorney, correct? And this person was supposed to have a jury trial Monday?
That was in Muskogee County, correct.
Is that your jurisdiction?
No, I'm Okmulgee and McIntosh.
So the text messages were blaming the victim for what he had done to Lisa.
No.
Okay. So he was set to go on trial for another case on that Monday. And he texted the victim the day before, and we're going to go over that because I have that, and threatened her, like, this is all on you, this is your fault, yada, yada, yada. We'll get to that.
My interpretation of the text, the Facebook Messenger messages that I read, was he was blaming her for his situation with the criminal case in Muskogee County.
Why is Okmulgee police instead of Henryetta?
Well, first of all, the scene was outside of the city limits of either Henryetta or Okmulgee and would fall under the jurisdiction of the sheriff's office. Okmulgee police is involved because we are part of, and I in fact command, the District 25 Violent Crime Task Force, which conducts violent crime investigations in both Okmulgee and McIntosh County.
Wait, he does what? All right. Is this guy elected in? Because this is a problem.
First of all, the scene was outside of the city limits of either Henryetta or Okmulgee and would fall under the jurisdiction of the sheriff's office. Okmulgee police is involved because we are part of, and I in fact command, the District 25 Violent Crime Task Force, which conducts violent crime investigations in both Okmulgee and McIntosh County.
He commands the Violent Crimes Task Force, and he left this scene with blood evidence inside. I hope this guy gets fired. I don't want him to feel the fire. I want him to get fired. How many other violent crimes has he fucked up? Oh my God, this is awful. And I actually command the violent crime task force. He says it with pride, as if this was a thorough, good investigation that he's got under his belt. Give me a break.
Again, with the timeline, I'm sorry, I know you don't have a lot of details, but can you give us an idea of how far apart these killings could be, or if they all happened at once?
I don't have any way to base any speculation on to give you a realistic timeline other than the distance between where the bodies were discovered. It could have happened in quick succession, or there could have been a significant amount of time between them. There's just absolutely no way for us to know.
I know you mentioned it already, but I'm just trying to get clarification. Can you explain again where the bodies were found and how close they were? It kind of sounds like maybe three were found close together, and then the other four were found like two different groups.
Yes, that's correct. From the McFadden residence, which is probably 100 yards off the road, approximately a quarter mile south and east of the residence, there is a creek. And the creek is within a tree line, but just barely. Ivy was found on the west side of that creek, approximately 100 to 150 yards away.
Creek town,
Brittany
dude.
Was found approximately another 100 to 150 yards away. Riley was found, and they were both on the east side of the creek. Then the other four decedents were all found together approximately another quarter mile more east than south, but southeast of where the three girls were found, in a heavily wooded area.
So they were found further away.
Yes. Yes.
Chief, what kind of impact does a tragedy like this have on the community?
Well, part of the problem that the community suffers with something like this is everybody wants to understand why. And like I said before, normal people can't understand why. People that perpetrate crimes like this are evil. And normal folks like us can't understand why.
Okay, I'm going to go back to where he describes where the bodies were found, and I'm going to look at this.
100 to 150 yards away, right. Ivy was found on the west side of that creek, approximately 100 to 150 yards away. Brittany was found, approximately another 100 to 150 yards away. Riley was found, and they were both on the east side of the creek. Then the other four decedents were all found together approximately another quarter mile more east than south, but southeast of where the three girls were found, in a heavily wooded area.
So they were found further away?
Yes. Yes.
Chief, what kind of impact does a tragedy like this have on the community?
Well, part of the problem that the community suffers with something like this is everybody wants to understand why. And like I said before, normal people can't understand why. People that perpetrate crimes like this are evil. And normal folks like us can't understand why they do that. So I think that besides the emotional trauma that people suffer because of the realization of what happened to these young kids, trying to figure out why is a challenge they'll never get past.
Was there anybody at the scene before all this happened that you've been able to determine who wasn't killed, or everybody who was there?
I have no evidence that anyone was at the scene leading up to the murders that was not killed.
Do you have any information? Was his resident served probation parole? Was he in compliance?
I don't have any information at all along those lines.
Were the bodies found with clothing, or were they all normal?
All bodies were clothed.
I think this was asked, but I'm just going to ask again. I mean, six people to shoot and kill, do you think that the three girls maybe were trying to run away? Any indicator that anyone tried to run away? That just seems like so many people to try and do that to without someone getting away.
Who's the lady to the right? Who's she, and why is she standing so far away from him? Who is she?
You're having the same difficulty that we have trying to figure out exactly what happened, because all we have is where the bodies were positioned and the injuries to them to try to indicate what happened, and there's just no way to know.
And do you think this, you know, that this was planned or spontaneous?
No way to know that.
And what is the district attorney's role in this? Now that
this is my task force.
Okay.
It's going to be important that this McFadden was going to go to McAllister.
What did she say? This is my task force. Is she the attorney? Is she the district attorney?
What is the district attorney's role in this? Now that
this is my task force.
Okay.
What kind of answer is that? What is the district attorney's role now? This is my task force. What? That's not an answer, is it?
It's been reported that Jesse McFadden was going to go to McAllister. Do you have any, before this happened, do you have an indication that actually happened or he was not seen or any evidence about that?
Based on information that we have available to us currently, we don't think they ever went to McAllister.
How did you all figure out that they didn't ever go to McAllister?
The property in McAllister belongs to Jesse McFadden's family members, and we interviewed them, and they were cooperative and told us that they had never come down there. They hadn't come down there that weekend.
Were there any security?
They had never come down there. And then he backtracks. They didn't come down there that weekend. You need to interrogate his fucking family about these restraints and shit that were in this house. Are you kidding me right now?
McFadden's family members, and we interviewed them, and they were cooperative and told us that they had never come down there. They hadn't come down there that weekend.
Were there any security or gaming cameras on the property that possibly could have captured anything?
Not that I've been made aware of.
Do you know when he dropped the car?
Made aware of? Were you not there, motherfucker?
Car to his neighbor? I mean, when was the last sighting of him?
I believe he was sighted in Henryetta proper Saturday night. When I can't tell you when he dropped the car or why. Anything I tell you would be a guess. All right, folks. I really appreciate your time. Thank you. And
can I ask one more question?
Sure.
You know, typically when there's homicides, murders, someone goes on trial. This someone is now deceased. What's next in this investigation to figure out what happened to bring pain disclosure? What's next?
We have been in contact with the families and have shared information. In fact, we met with the families today prior to this press conference to give them the information that we gave you all, so they would hear it from us and not from the news.
What did they have to hear first? That you don't fucking know anything? That you didn't collect any evidence? This woman is a... Oh, my God. I don't like any of them either. They all give me the creeps. I'm having Moscow 2.0 vibes.
Media.
Except this guy's unlike Fry. He's not afraid of the podium. Fry's afraid of his own fucking shadow. This guy is like grabbing the podium. He's owning it because he's the commander. He's the commander in chief. So there's nothing in his mind that can top that in his ego. He thinks he's the commander. He's the end all be all. He has no qualms about getting up to that podium and telling these people, I don't know.
Again, there are questions that will never get answered because the only people that know are no longer here.
Wow.
We will continue to document everything that we have found and anything that we discover in follow-up interviews moving forward and generate a report. We will submit that report to the district attorney's office for her review as a formality because there is no prosecution to be had here.
Can you describe the reaction of the families when this information was
delivered? Today? I was not present, so I'm not sure. Yes, sir.
What am I saying? Just for the purposes of our understanding, do you think you might be able to help us out and give and present some type of like map of like the crime scene that might help us better explain for people how spread out the crime scene was?
Currently, I don't have one for you. At some point in the future, crime scene investigators will map it. I have no idea how long that'll take.
Okay. Thank you.
You bet.
They don't have a drawing that they can provide to reporters, like a map where they can mark where the bodies were found. He doesn't want to give anything.
At this point, has the case been ruled as a murder suicide?
We don't ever just rule a case, to use your term.
Oh my God, he's such a dick. So the question was, look at his face.
What do I tell him?
He asks, if this has been ruled a murder-suicide. And he thought carefully before answering.
Okay, thank you.
You bet.
At this point, has the case been ruled as a murder-suicide?
We don't ever just rule a case, to use your term.
To use your term, we don't just rule a case. We don't know who this guy is, but we didn't do shit when he killed 5 people, 6 people.
But we don't have any evidence to believe that it's anything other than 6 murders and a suicide.
Thank you, Chief.
In closing, what's your message to parents? This has affected so many people. We've heard from victims' families. We have no idea of this person's convictions, previous history. What's your message? And it sounds like, I don't know if he was easily available out there. What's your message to parents as you see this?
I want to be clear. All right? I do not believe that the parents of Brittany or Ivy did anything wrong. And they are devastated by the loss of their children. That being said, I don't think you can be too careful with your kids. Know where they're going and who they're going to be with. All right, folks, thank you.
Well, that was action-packed, wasn't it? Craziness. I know, you guys are infuriated just like me. And no, I agree, Robin. There's no way this can be let go. But now we have like more people involved. So like the Oklahoma Bureau Investigation, whatever they're called there. I've got another video. This is a shorter one. And never mind my little banners. I screen recorded on my phone. So, all right, let's watch this.
The ball.
We can't have parents go through OPF. I'm angry. This should have never happened.
His daughter Ivy was only 14 years old when Jesse McFadden murdered her. Okmulgee police say Ivy died from a gunshot wound to the head. Her family has 0 answers, couldn't say goodbye, and has no closure. So now, they're looking for it.
I feel that my daughter, even right now, is standing behind me, telling me, Dad, keep going. Keep doing this.
Phone or phone case?
Thursday afternoon, News 4 was invited by Webster and his family to take a closer look at where his daughter took her last breath. Behind these walls, the family found sex and bondage devices. In one of the bedrooms were restraints bolted into the bed frame. There was also a shelf filled with books about witchcraft. 10 feet away in the kitchen, another restraint with chains and locks still attached. Although there were reportedly 4 bodies found in this home, we didn't see any blood stains, no blood splatters. In the back room, the most shocking find of it all, crucial items that had not been collected.
That's them. Hey, that's them.
Okay, is that hers?
Yep. Okay, hold on.
Call the sheriff. Yep. Don't touch him. Don't move him.
Ivy Webster's cell phone was tucked away in a laundry room cabinet, along with 2 other cell phones and 2 laptops. In the same room, syringes, what appears to be drug residue, and various items the family believes was used to torture their daughter before she was murdered. None of it collected by law enforcement until this family called the Okmulgee County Sheriff's Office and asked them to come back to the home and retrieve these items.
There you go.
Pictures were snapped and the items finally collected, but not without a brief explanation as to why it hadn't been done before.
I want more done.
The problem is, we don't know what else to do. Like,
there's a story to be told here.
Right.
We don't know what happened.
Don't know what else to do. I'm going to say this.
Since we don't have the only person that can tell us what happened.
He's dead. But we can try to piece it together.
And I want to say this was not done right. No crime scene tape.
We are open to any suggestions you all can give.
I'm saying this. They didn't do their job and the whole world's going to know it.
But what would this accomplish?
I'm a grieving parent that my daughter got raped and murdered, and you're telling me right now that I don't have a right to know what happened? The story's right here. It's right here. And it's still sitting here. Still!
Disgusted with the investigation into his daughter's murder, he only saw more uncollected evidence on his walkout. Another phone in the top drawer of a nightstand, several computer towers, and a check made out to a local storage company still sitting in plain sight.
I'm upset. Healing. Trying to heal. Still confused. Still a lot of answers that need to be given.
We've spent the day trying to find out why the cell phones, the laptops, and other evidence was left behind. We were told by a sheriff's investigator in Okmulgee County that they were only responsible for searching the property, not the house. He said the house was the sole responsibility of the OSBI. Well, the OSBI confirms its investigators were in the house, but they tell us those investigators were only providing assistance to the Okmulgee Police Department.
Assistance?
Today, neither the Okmulgee Police Department, nor the Sheriff's Office, nor the DA's office would comment for the story. The OSBI did issue a statement saying, quote, "The OSBI will continue to support and assist our law enforcement partners and grieve with the families of this horrible event. The investigation is still ongoing."
All right, Kaylee.
So that is still confusing to me. It's still confusing to me. Someone said something like they feel like they've seen that cop before. Where do you feel like you've seen that cop? Did he do like another case? I'm just curious if there's like another case that he did a press conference on or not. I can't remember who said that in the chat. Okay, so the next thing we have, and someone said that the owner of the home owns a construction company, and that's why those trailers are there. So now we're going to fast forward, and let's do this. Where were the bodies found? He said they were all outside, but the family didn't see any blood inside. So where were they killed? That's my question. Where were they killed? If they were shot, they were obviously all shot outside. I mean, you're not going to be shot in the head and run, but we don't know if there were other injuries, right? Yeah, I agree, speculation. I mean, the things that were laying around. How could you overlook that and just leave? Let me show you guys. I'll show you the picture of the property again. Let me make it smaller. I was looking at that truck. It looks like there's people putting stuff in the back of that truck. There's like people pulling down the back. But they were found all around the water here on the other side of the creek, even, I think. And two of them were found in a heavily wooded area. So there's no telling where. And then the reporters asked for a map just to kind of better understand and to show people to better understand where they were found. And he said there was nothing like that. His brother owns the house? Oh, hell no. The dad reminds me of the brother in that Naomi case. I think somebody mentioned that Naomi. I don't know how to say her last name. I didn't follow that one. But I remember her brother was bearded with glasses. Is that what somebody was talking about? That he looks like him? Here's a picture of that brother. He's redheaded. I don't think this guy has red hair. So that's the property. That's the creek, as they call it. And let's see what we've got. Okay, this is where it talks about. Let me get them off here so it's not confusing. Okay, so this is where it tells a story of when he texts that girl. So this is a story from May 5th, and this is on NBC News. Facebook message arrived Sunday night. Jesse McFadden wrote that he was doing well at a marketing job and had made a great life. Just, quote, like I promised I would do with you. Quote, now it's all gone, he said in his message, which he sent with a photo of himself staring directly at the camera. Quote, I told you I wouldn't go back. And then he said, quote, this is all on you for continuing this. Hours later, authorities found the bodies of McFadden, his wife, her three teenage children, and two other teens. On Wednesday, which is last week, the police chief leading the investigation into the killings said that McFadden, a convicted rapist who spent nearly 17 years in prison before his 2020 release, had likely shot all six in the head before killing himself. This is the text he sent. Ew. But why does it say Holly unsent a message with his little thing? This looks fake to me. Oh, he's Holly Days. He made the name Holly Days and messaged her. Ew, let's see if we can see what's in the background of this picture, because this would have been the night that he did it. That's creepy as hell. His wife is also Holly. So he's got a wife, Holly, and then another wife, Holly. So he hooked up with this Holly and then married another Holly. Oh, my God. Jen DC. Yuck. Oh, speculation. Okay. I thought you were talking about the brother. I just remember he had the same kind of beard. It's too methodical, and with his PC setup, I'm suspicious this had online or distribution elements. Doesn't seem like he was an amateur the way he organized and lured. You might be right, Just Mikes. Good to see you, by the way. Hey, Rusty. Rusty Griswold. If they thoroughly investigated the guy's house, they might find a connection to other offenders. Right. They might find other victims. Okay, let's open this picture up and zoom in and see the background and see if there's anything weird. Why would he set a picture just staring? What the hell is hanging off the wall in the background? There's no telling in that house, though. Weird. He looks like he hasn't slept in days, honestly. I think these, you know, honestly, you guys, and Robin, I think you're the one that said this yesterday, and I completely agree. I feel like these drugs that people are doing are mixed and, like, cut with some bad shit, and people are losing their minds. I don't know what that is. And what's the blue thing? Is that like something over the window? And is that a cat behind him? If so, who's got the cat? Someone, if CEO, you said you live near there, go save the cat. It looks like an orange cat. All right, so let's read about these messages. Okay, so this woman was set to testify against him in a child abuse trial scheduled to begin the same day the bodies were found. And I don't know why they won't name the woman. The woman, Caitlin Babb, 23, provided the message to NBC. It was sent from an account with the name Holly Days. The police chief leading the investigation, Joe Prentice, that's our idiot, Joe Prentice, said he had reviewed the message and wasn't sure if it was sent before or after the killings. In an email, Prentice said he wasn't willing to read too much into it. He's putting this shit in writing, too.
What?
It seemed to me he was blaming her for his situation for continuing the criminal case, he said. In an interview, Babb provided a harrowing account of how McFadden allegedly lured her into a predatory relationship as a teen, convincing her from prison that they had a future together, and threatening her when the relationship was revealed and charges were filed. She said that she read the message as McFadden blaming her for the killings because she refused to back down from child pornography and soliciting sexual conduct communication with a minor charges. I'm sure she told the police this when she said, hey, he message me these texts, and here we have the chief investigator of the violent crime task force saying, I'm not putting much into it. And then Babs goes on to say, I thought I was protecting people. I thought this was going to keep him from hurting more people, she added. He took away my innocence, my childhood. I didn't want him to do that to anyone ever again. Babb said the failure of prosecutors to ever try the case filed in 2017, she says, was a miscarriage in the state's justice system. They could have prevented these deaths, she said. This never should have happened. I don't know how many times I told them, he's a dangerous man. You're putting little girls in danger. I don't know how many times I screamed at the top of my lungs for someone to care. Now look what happened. Muskogee County District Attorney Larry Edwards did not respond to comment. And CBS affiliate reported Tuesday that a trial had been set multiple times and delayed because of several factors, including a prosecutor leaving the job and one breaking her foot the day before a trial. What? This is Caitlin Babb. Babb, a manager for a health insurance company in Texas, says she met McFadden by accident in 2015 after moving to Oklahoma from Texas to live with her grandparents. She had a new phone number and one night got a message from McFadden. He was trying to reach the person the number previously belonged to. What? She responded, a transplant with no friends in her new town. In McFadden, she found a person who seemed friendly and genuinely interested in her. He didn't disclose that he was in prison until later and described his rape conviction as a misunderstanding. McFadden asked for proof of her age, so she provided him with an image of her learner's permit. The back and forth quickly turned sexual, and his request became increasingly invasive. It was no longer, can you take your shirt off and take a picture? She said, it was, how far can we get without seeing each other in person? I knew I was doing something I shouldn't have been doing, she said. He made me feel like he cared. Even though I was only 16, I felt like he loved me. I was brainwashed. The text, letters, and phone and video calls continued for at least a year and a half. Even after her grandparents discovered a letter in her bedroom and reported it to the Oklahoma Department of Corrections. Why is this guy able to just scathe? Babs' grandmother, Patsy Pappen, said McFadden had addressed it to a P.O. box that Babs said he'd asked her to open. McFadden signed the note as Babs' husband. How did she get a P.O. box as a minor? Can you do that? I was absolutely reeling, said Pappen, 64. Inmate profile documents from the department show that on July 8th, 2016, a prison officer confiscated a smartphone from McFadden. A forensic audit showed sexually themed conversations, videos, and pictures with someone whose name was redacted, but whose date of birth, which is in the document, matches Babs. Charges against McFadden were filed September 29th, 2016. 17. A lawyer for McFadden, Rex Starr, has not responded to multiple requests for comment. Court documents show McFadden planned to argue that it wasn't him in contact with Bab, but another inmate using the same phone. After the phone was confiscated, McFadden continued to call Bab. This is according to her. And she'd become so compliant to McFadden's demands, at one point she drove roughly 2 hours from her grandparents' home in Norman to the county courthouse in Muskogee to ask them to drop the case. The charges prompted a shift in McFadden's demeanor, and he began threatening her. It all turned for her at that point. Babs said she dropped out of high school, left her grandparents' home in Texas, and slowly stopped responding for Texas, and slowly stopped responding to McFadden's calls. Aren't jail calls recorded? Eventually, she blocked his number. Oh, maybe this was after he got out. I don't know. And told the district attorney she would testify against him. I realized he didn't love me. He was sick. On Sunday night, Bab was preparing to travel to Oklahoma the next day for her long-awaited day in court. She hadn't spoken to McFadden in years when she noticed a Facebook message request around 8 p.m. Initially, Bab was confused about what McFadden's message meant. Perhaps he'd lost his job and was blaming her for it, she recalled thinking. The message also suggested, quote, must not really care anymore, because contacting her was a violation of the terms of his bail. Babs didn't respond. She took a screenshot and sent it to Edwards, the district attorney. The next morning, Bab got a call from the prosecutor, alerting her to another delay in the case. McFadden's lawyer had asked for a continuance over an issue related to McFadden's phone. What? So the prosecutor was delaying it anyway, and then a half hour later, the prosecutor called and told her of a missing persons notice about McFadden, Brittany Brewer, and Ivy Webster. Bab said she immediately packed a bag and rented an Airbnb 45 minutes away. I was terrified he was coming for me. In the days since the bodies were discovered, Bab said she's experienced an onslaught of emotions, guilt and anger, frustration and grief. Her grandma said she's resilient. She would not back down from this. I'm so proud of her. So I don't know about Babs. And then here is another video. Watch this.
Suicide that shocked the state and nation, leaving seven people dead, including five children.
Brittany Brewer, Ivy Webster, Tiffany Guess, Michael Mayo, and Riley Allen, all between the ages of 13 and 17, along with Holly Guess, each shot to death.
Investigators have confirmed convicted sex offender Jesse McFadden killed those six victims, then himself. Earlier this week, law enforcement released the home where the murders occurred, giving it back to the property owner. And as of Tuesday afternoon, there was no longer an active investigation at this location.
In an effort to figure out what led...
Released the crime scene the next day? Seven bodies? What?
This horrific murder-suicide, the families of the victims have launched their own search for answers.
The parents of teenager Ivy Webster wanted to go through the crime scene, hoping they could find something that would explain what happened. Once the crime tape was removed from the home and the scene released by law enforcement, the family went inside.
They left yesterday devastated by what they found. News 4's Kaylee Olivas was with the family the entire time. She has this News 4 exclusive.
Here we go.
We do want to warn you, the images you're about to see from inside the home are disturbing. It was hard to watch Ivy's family as they discovered what they believe is crucial evidence that was left behind by law enforcement. In a matter of minutes, they found their own daughter's cell phone tucked away in a cabinet. That was just the beginning. Now they're wondering whether law enforcement dropped the ball.
We can't have parents go through OPF. I'm angry. This should have never happened.
Oh, we already watched
his daughter
this one,
Ivy was only 14 years old when Jesse McFadden murdered her.
Yeah, we watched this one. I wanted to see the pictures of the evidence they found. Hold on. 2004, Jesse McFadden asked the judge for a lesser sentence. Did you guys know that? Look at this picture. See the blue tarp out there? Is that one of the bodies? What do you guys think? It doesn't even seem real. All right. Let's look at some of these photos. That's what I want to see here. Okay, so this is photos taken by the news when they were in the house with the family. So the news actually caught these on all this stuff on video. And you can see like some blood. There's padlocks and a chain bolted to this table thingy. What else? I mean, what the fuck? How can they just ignore stuff like that? Here's another view of the house. The House of Horrors. And then they put this banner on the fence there. I believe this is Ivy Webster's parents. That's Ivy Webster's parents. Yeah, he breaks my heart. When that cop talked to him like that, what suggestions do y'all have? Like, really? I don't even understand that shit. I thought there was more pictures than of the evidence than that. Ooh, creepy. There it is at night. OSBI returns to collect more evidence. This is 2 days ago. They have a tent set up and they have the crime scene van there. But are these cops going to have to pay the price for not doing their jobs is the question. Do these families have a lawyer? Oh, yeah, the lawyer's statement. That's what we have to pull up. That's where we found out there was 32 different phones and people. There's a dog. There's a dog. Why is there a... Someone go get that dog. Look at the dog. Guys. I don't like that there's a dog there. I don't trust that those cops took care of that dog. Oh, that makes me ill. Okay. The lawyer for one of the victims of a mass homicide said 32 different cell phones and people used a home on the property as their location address. Cameron Spradling, the lawyer for Ivy Webster, one of the people McFadden killed, said 32 different cell phones and people used a home on the property as their location address. He said this information was obtained by his law firm's PI, and they have informed the Oklahoma State Bureau of Investigation. And then it said that the OSBI took over and found devices in it. And then now they have a law they're trying to pass. Let's watch this.
The OSBI, the investigators for them, were back at the house of Jesse McFadden near Henryetta today. That's where investigators found the bodies of five kids, McFadden and his wife, 1 week ago.
Fox 23's Michelle White has been talking to the family of Ivy Webster, one of the teenagers killed. She reports on the new information she learned today.
Justin Webster is the father of Ivy Webster, one of the five children who were slain here on this land last week. OSBI would only confirm that they are now investigating the killings of five children and two adults, believed to be done by convicted rapist Jesse McFadden. But Webster told me that OSBI investigators told him they took additional electronic devices from the house on Monday and that they searched the pond and the property. This is after the property owner's son let Webster into the house, where he found his daughter's phone and other phones in the laundry room.
Where the computer was.
Okay, so I don't know. It doesn't sound to me like the suspect, Jesse McFadden's brother, owns it. Because the son of the owner, if that's Jesse's nephew, that's what you guys are saying. I don't know. But the son of the owner of the property let these guys in.
Handcuffs were and the syringe with substance still in the syringe. And he just opened the cabinets behind the computer desk right next to the washer and dryer And he yelled out, "There's phones in here." And we ran to the back, and I couldn't, the shelf was up high, and I couldn't see the cases on the phone. So I pulled my phone out to look up there, and I took a picture of it, and it was our daughter's phone, along with two other phones on either side of it.
He says the Okmulgee County Sheriff and Okmulgee Police failed in their joint investigation of the murders of his daughter Ivy, her friends Brittany Brewer, Tiffany Guess, Riley Allen, and Michael Mayo, and their mother, Holly McFadden.
I called the sheriff's office immediately to let them know that we found my daughter's phone and possibly other phones, and that they left evidence in the house. And I expressed at that point my frustration that stuff wasn't getting found and an investigation wasn't done properly.
OSBI assisted the Okmulgee County Sheriff's Office and Okmulgee Police in the investigation. But after that investigation came under scrutiny when Ivy's family members and a reporter were allowed into this house last Thursday, OSBI took over the investigation.
Oh, they blurred it out.
Covering news that matters. Michelle White, Fox 23 News.
Well, I'll have to gather those together, see if I can find a bunch of pictures. If you guys have any, you can send them to the email. You can put exclamation point email, and it will put the email in the chat, and you can send any pictures that you find. I don't know how much time I'm going to have. You know, because I'm getting ready to leave. Hi, Vince. So I don't know how much time I'm going to have to, you know, dig into this week. But I think I am going to cancel my Daybell thing just because there's really not a whole lot to report. There's some tidbits here and there. But they've wrapped up their case. And they're going to be doing closing arguments on Thursday. So I think I'm going to wait until after Thursday to do the update. And just to let you know, since I'm going to be in Michigan, I'm going to be covering some Michigan cases while I'm up there for you guys. One thing we're going to be covering is the case of White Boy Rick, a.k.a. Rick Wershe. I'm not sure if you guys know the story of Rick Wershe, but we're going to be going over that. That would be one of our Detroit stories. And then I'm going to take a little drive by the home that Aileen Wuornos, the serial killer, grew up in. She grew up in Troy, Michigan. And then, of course, I'm going to be going to the Crumbly hearing on the 15th of May in Pontiac at the Oakland County Court. And then I will take you guys and get some footage of where the Crumblies lived. Maybe I'll see some of their neighbors. I'll go by the school. And, of course, get whatever I can. So that's what's coming up during my trip. I'm going to have some downtime because my kids all have jobs. And, of course, this is my job. So I'll be doing my job while they're doing their job. So, yeah, but isn't that crazy? She grew up in Michigan. Her ashes, Eileen's, are actually scattered in Fostoria, Michigan, which is a really, really small rural area under some trees there. So she had a fucked up life, y'all. Miss Aileen. But what else? What else? What else? So Daybell, I mean, really what I wanted to laugh about with you guys, and I'm sorry that I don't have time because I think we could have a kick-ass laugh about Chad's nickname for his peen and everything. It's Storm. But we will go over all of this stuff, trust me. But I want to get through the closing statements. We can kind of dissect those because that will lay out what they think happened. So interesting enough, Lori's attorneys, they said, we have no witnesses. We have no questions. We have no witnesses. We don't think that they even proved their case. So we rest. the storm. I know. She gripped the storm. But Potato and I decided that we're going to do a read-through of Chad's novel, his romance novel, to Lori. So that'll be coming up soon. I know. Maybe call the Humane Society there in that area in Henryetta. Look up the, you want me to, will somebody call if I give you the number? Call the Humane Society, tell them there's animals at the house, or see if they got the animals from that house. What is the address? Somebody have the address? The address of the house? I wanted to pull that up on a map before we leave. Henryetta Animal Aid and Rescue. It's a nonprofit organization in Henryetta, Oklahoma. Here, I'm going to put this in chat. If somebody wants to please, like, call and find out. Okay, here's the number for the nonprofit. If someone wants to call and ask, 14600, and it's Holly Road? What?
What?
So he's got two Hollies and a Holly Road? Come on now. Can that even be real? I'll be damned. Holly Road. The fuck? Why does this all seem so weird? That is the damn address, though. Thank you, Kim. Thank you, Speculation. Speculation's going to call about the dog. There was also an orange cat in the picture he allegedly sent the night before as well. Yeah, the neighbors are pretty far away. Nobody was hearing shit. But you would definitely hear gunshots, y'all. You would hear gunshots. Come on. I wonder if this is the treed area. Hardly any water in this overhead. This is from 2023. You guys got to see this dog's face. Look. She is out. Look at her with her head on the pillow. Do we think it'll be a longer or shorter deliberation than Letitia? Gosh, I just don't know. I just don't know. Daisy, it's always weird. I know. We can't drop our little guy down there, though. It's dumb. But look, there's none of those. I don't see those tractor trailer things. Let's Zillow this house. 14600 Holly Road. Hold on. Oh, Daily Mail always has good picks. Let's see what they have. This is Nathan Brewer, Brittany Brewer's dad. I guess they don't have pictures. Hold on. Let's go to, oh, let's do this. Bella, enough. What was the address again? Shit. 14600. I don't want to dox anyone, but shit. Three residents. I don't think it's going to let me see their names. Hold on. Let's keep going. Voter records. That we're doing some live deep dive with Jay. Because I'm nosy like that. 14600. Teresa Pruitt, 55. Registration date 11/23/2020. Teresa Pruitt. Who's, look at this name, Siratip L. Pruitt. Terry Lynn. We've got, they're related to Hobgood, Parsons, Van Ness, Doty, Dodson. She's got a thing. Oh, never mind. It wants me to pay. All right, let's go back. Here's Zillow. Oh, that's 14680. That's not it. Sex offenders. This is Henryetta. Look at all the sex offenders in this little area. Sick. Sick. 12 addresses could not be displayed on the map. Good Lord. How do we see who they are? Let's see if that dude's on here. Bella's talking to you guys. I don't even... Why isn't his name in here? McFadden, right? That's weird. What the fuck? Gigi McCormick, Jennifer Lynn Johnson. Return to sender, no such street. For some reason, this came up, but I don't see the address, but it came up for this address. Tynan D. Dill? I don't know. What is this? 'Why did this come up? Fucking weird. This is what's called a rabbit hole. Okay, here's one, a report of him. Ew. God, he's a weirdo. He was born 8/24/1983. He's 10 years younger than me. Holy. Rape, first degree, 11/14/03, Oklahoma, Petersburg County. And his middle name's Lee. There we have that name again. Lee. Okay, so the most recent tenant is Holly Guess. Past residents are Jesse McFadden, Joseph Guess, Robert Sherrill, Teresa Sherrill, and Teresa Prewitt. Prewitt. So here's Holly. She's lived in Arkansas and Oklahoma. Holly Guess, Holly Mayo. Joseph Guess, Dustin, Heather Mayo, Jeanette Mayo, Joseph Guess, Timothy Guess, Timothy May, Amy Martz, Brandy Mayo, Michael Mayo, Cody Haymans, Darren Pettigrew. He's lived in Kansas, Jesse. These are all his relatives, I guess, all these people. Joseph Guess. Robert Sherrill, 70. Maybe he's the owner. He might own the place. He might own the joint. Because Teresa's 66. Then there's another Teresa that's 55. I don't fucking know what these people. Michael Mayo, 40. Mary Fernandez. Teresa Prewitt. All these people had this name. See, Lonnie Prewitt. I don't see 32 names, but this is just a random Google search. I don't know why I can't pull up any records. Have they never sold this house? This is just a disgusting case. Like, there's definitely more to this story. I mean, would you guys not agree? Here's another guy. Jeremy Johnson has this May 2006. He lived there. Man, I don't know. Seems a bit sketchy to me. Teresa Prewitt, Mary Delaney. I've never seen an address with six numbers. Look at all their addresses. Maybe they own a lot of rentals. Fuck. It's a lot of properties, man. Yeah, so there we go. This is possible associates. Who knows? Hopefully they will get more answers from the U-Haul of evidence they allegedly took away, right? I bet they never did either, because there's no records of this house. Yeah, I mean, we don't know what this lady knew. I mean, she knew, had to know he was a sex offender. Didn't they talk while he was in prison? Isn't that how they met? Hold on, something came up. Oh, look. Humane Society, Okmulgee Humane Society. Here's their number. I'll give it to you guys in the chat. In case that other one doesn't work out, speculation, here is the actual county. Well, we don't know what's on those phones. There could be evidence on those phones that gives a cue or a clue as to what happened. We don't know if it was recorded, anything, or if he recorded shit before then. Yeah, she knew what was going on there. I love that you guys are concerned about the animals. It's really sweet. I love you guys. Oh, the law, the Knight's Law. So they're pushing for harsher punishments for convicted sex offenders, is what that means. So it sounds like the Brewer and the Webster families are pushing for a new law. They found restraints with locks and chains, sex and bondage devices. And the Violent Crime Task Force just walked past these things. When the investigator was questioned, the problem is, I don't know what else to do. Useless. Hopefully for the justice for these families, they'll get some answers. But it did look like there was a call out to that house, but it's not pulling up on a sheriff log. It just says possible vehicle accident, but it's not telling me. Oh, 8/26/2022. Interesting. Okay. Well, like I said, you know, this is probably going to be evolving, and I'm sure now that they have this lawyer, he's going to be slowly releasing things in order to keep this on the hot seat. So if you guys could share this out to all of your social media platforms for me. Let's get the word out about this. Let's get everyone infuriated so the pressure stays on these guys.
These nuts.
I didn't see him, Toy, on the registry, but I might be looking. I don't know. I thought it was the whole state. I didn't see him. Speculation, please keep us updated. Angie, can you throw the email up? And Speculation, please keep us updated on what you find out about the animals, and I can post it in the community so everybody knows. I am going to get going. I've got to get ready. I'll keep you guys posted on what's going on, and I will be in touch with you guys later when I'm in the mitten, I guess. So if I don't talk to you guys before then, everybody stay safe. Thank you for letting me know that, Leslie Watkins. Thank you, Angie. And thank you, everybody. Hey, Jammers. Hey, Crow. Hey, Barbie B. Hope you guys are all doing well today. Thank you, Melissa B. Thank you, Cheryl, for being here. Have a great day, you guys. Dance it out. Oops.
I don't give a damn. I don't really care about you and your problems. I don't
Bye, Disneyland. Bye, Mandy. You talk Bye, Nomad. I didn't see you guys. Bye, Daisy.
About you and your
Bye,
problems.
For the record. Bye, Jason.
I don't give a damn.
Bye, Jen.
It was Roro.
What?
If you say
if you wanna feel, fizz on the rail, but I'm feeling differently. You're making plans to get to friends, but don't wanna face the fact. I ain't got time, I ain't got time, I ain't got time for that. Staying up late, sleeping all day, dreaming about Cadillacs. Buying no shoes, hanging by the pool, sipping on coke and jack.
Do you mind holding the microphone down and then aiming it up at your chin?
New members into the lounge. Angie is our gatherer today. We're going to call people who donate memberships gatherers. Thank you so much, you guys. I'll talk to you soon. Thanks for the safe travels. I will be as safe as I possibly can. I'll post in the community, so make sure you are subscribed.
Bye, Jennifer.
Ooh, Lakeside. I will, Robin. Bye. I'm going to miss you guys.